let's move on to our fifth change, which focuses on data architecture. These updates to our data architecture framework. We've introduced information mapping and customer master data management within the information architecture to serve as reference models. These are intended as guidelines only, since your organization may utilize different types of master data, such as employee and project master data. Here are two visualization examples. The first is an information map. Information concepts and their interactions with business capabilities. And this additional diagram. Today, everyone recognizes the need for digital transformation, and they place great importance on data capabilities, data management capabilities. What exactly are these data management capabilities? This is TOGAF framework diagram, a capability model for data management. When setting up a CDO organization, led by a chief data officer, you'll need to implement data governance, ensure data protection, establish master data management, develop data science initiatives, and deliver data services. Data management skills are essential, as shown in this diagram, which aligns with the renowned data management body of knowledge, commonly known as the DMBOK. In fact, DAMA has fully incorporated the DMBOK framework in its 10th edition. While I don't mean to focus too much on the DMBOK, DAMA does cover many of these concepts extensively. The sixth major update focuses on government-specific adaptations, particularly regarding the aspects you're already familiar with. Indeed, these changes. Currently, the organization has made a small but significant step by introducing the GRM, or Government Reference Model. This framework has been widely adopted by numerous governments, including India and its regions, as well as Malaysia and other nations. You'll see, Malaysia, take the Australian government, Australia, then there's the UK government, the British government, the US government, the American administration. Actually, numerous governments have adopted this system, including Uganda and Bhutan. This system is widely adopted. Taiwan government, they've all implemented this system. The system proved highly effective, despite its minimal entry points. It establishes a comprehensive reference framework, covering international affairs and commerce, national defense and security, general governmental services at local level, youth and education, among other sectors. If you're interested in digital government services, smart governance systems, or similar initiatives, particularly in the military's digital transformation, there are crucial elements you should consider. However, as I mentioned, it's just scratching the surface. There's much more depth that hasn't been explored yet. However, beneath the surface, there's substantial content to unpack. TOGAF has evolved to become more than just a framework for enterprises. It extends beyond business applications, reaching into, as you might expect, government sectors, public sector and defense organizations. Moving on to the seventh major update, which addresses the evolution of application pricing models. Let me quickly walk you through. We have two key architectural guides: Microservices Architecture, or MPSA, and Service-Oriented Architecture. The latter, being a well-established approach, both frameworks serve as integration reference models. This is the integration reference model. The integration reference model, known as the integration reference model, abbreviated as HRM. Let me give you a simple example. SFA governance framework, supporting both IT and architectural governance. The IT governance aspect, combined with architectural governance. This framework, in fact, microservices represent form. It's a form of SFA, specifically a variant of it, called microservice architecture, or alternatively, simply known as microservices. It represents an architectural style, with its own governance reference model for microservices. Now, what you see here is just a framework diagram, which encompasses extensive underlying content. However, in today's session, we won't delve into these details. In TOGAF 10th edition, you'll need to study microservices architecture, along with various architectural patterns like SLA, service governance, and related concepts, as core requirements. Now, let's look at what we call a monolithic architecture. Here we have a microservices architecture, MSA, using microservices. Now, to identify these microservices, let's consider what's the heritage aspect. What's that about? We can apply domain-driven design to identify this. That works. Let's focus on this. Wow. Apparently, TOGAF isn't too fond of this approach. I probably shouldn't say this, but to be honest, TOGAF really isn't keen on it. However, this feature is actually quite good and really useful. Take it or leave it. It's up to you. Feel free to use it if you find it helpful. However, in TOGAF, at least version 10, doesn't mention this specifically. Though TOGAF's actual guidelines do reference this concept, so I believe it's acceptable. It takes a neutral stance. This represents moving on